We are now going to begin the part two of the chemical messengers. And so with this, we're going to be talking about the functional classification of the chemical messengers, classifying our chemical messengers into two different categories. We can classify them based on their functional property. So in other words, how they operate, how do they work? And we can classify them into their chemical composition as well. So this lecture is specifically going to be focusing only on the functional classification. Once this is complete, then we'll move into the chemical classification. So this is just so that you can look at your outline and get the big picture of where we're going. This is our roadmap, if you will. So the goal now is to go through the functional classification. Again, these are going to be types of indirect communication, looking at how our chemical messengers can function as a paracrine messenger, a neurotransmitter messenger, a hormone, or a neurohormone. With a functional classification, there's always the question of, well, what do I need to know? And so when we go through each of these functional classifications, it's going to be very important, first off, that you realize, is this a type of direct or indirect communication? Hopefully you'll already be able to guess that, since our secretory cell and our target cells are not physically connected in any of these types. The other thing you need to know is there a specific name for the messenger? So in some instances, I'll be giving you specific names for messengers. You'll also need to know specific names for target cells, if there are any, which there will be in some cases, and even the specific name for the secretory cell as well. We want to know, where do the messengers go? Do they only travel through the interstitial fluid? Do they only travel through the blood? Or do they have to travel through both? And do the secretory cells and target cells need to be nearby, or can they be far away from one another? In other words, is this a short distance communication, or is this a long distance communication? You should also know some examples of chemical messengers that operate as paracrine transmitters, as neurotransmitters, as hormones, or even as neurohormones. And then the last thing is, do all these messengers actually require a receptor? A very important concept for you to think about. All right, so this is the basics of your indirect or intercellular communication. So everything we're going to be talking about from this moment on is indirect, or indirect forms of communication. So again, that means that the secretory cell and the target cell are not physically connected. And so the big picture is that we have a secretory cell, and that secretory cell secretes the ligand, which, if you recall, we're also going to be referring to it as a chemical messenger. So the ligand then has to travel through the interstitial fluid, and I'll abbreviate that IF, and or, so it can only go through the interstitial fluid, or it may travel through the interstitial fluid and the blood. Certain ligands only travel through the interstitial fluid. Other ligands have to travel through the interstitial fluid, then enter the blood to reach the target cell. Now, this is where the ligand must bind to the receptor. That's one receptor, and if you notice, that receptor is on the plasma membrane. I have another receptor here, and if you notice, that's in the cytoplasm, or it could be in the nucleoplasm. So when the ligand binds, it comes in and it binds to the receptor on the plasma membrane or in the target cell. And by in the target cell, it could be in the cytoplasm or it could be in the nucleoplasm. So when the ligand binds to the receptor, this is going to bring about what's called a target cell response. And so this is the big picture. What we're going to be doing after this functional classification is looking at specifically, how does this happen? Okay, so let's go through each of the types of functional classification. So we're going to begin with paracrine signals. So if you have a chemical or a ligand that's functioning as a paracrine signal, your secretory cell and your target cell are nearby, but not physically connected. The secretory cell has to synthesize and secrete my paracrine ligand, which could be, for example, histamine, or a growth factor, a clotting factor, or a cytokine. That paracrine signal has to travel through the interstitial fluid. Then it has to bind to the receptor. And then we get a target cell response. And again, remember that the target cell is nearby the secretory cell, but they're not physically connected. Next, we have the neurotransmitters. So some ligands function as neurotransmitters. So our secretory cell is called a presynaptic neuron. Our target cell is called a postsynaptic cell. And this postsynaptic cell could be a postsynaptic neuron, for example, or this postsynaptic cell could be an effector. Effectors are muscle and glands. Our ligand is the neurotransmitter. So these are the components. Now, the secretory cell and the target cell are usually nearby, but here's the catch. Sometimes you can have a presynaptic neuron that's over a meter long. So it's a meter long, and then you have your target cell. So in that particular case, your communication would be long distance. But for the most part, it's going to be nearby. All right, so let's look at the flow of things here. So we start off at the top here because we know our secretory cell will synthesize and secrete our neurotransmitter, which is our ligand. So then the ligand, once it's secreted, it has to travel across what we're going to call the synapse. And in this case, the synapse is interstitial fluid. So once that neurotransmitter travels through the interstitial fluid, or what we call the synapse, then the neurotransmitter has to bind to the receptor. And once it binds to the receptor, we get a target cell response. So you see there are some common themes here. The secretory cell is always synthesizes and secreting the ligand. The ligand either travels through the interstitial fluid and the blood, or only the interstitial fluid. The ligand binds to a receptor, and you get a target cell response. The next type of functional classification is when our ligands, or our chemical messengers, function as hormones. So here, our secretory cell is called an endocrine cell. Anytime you hear the term endocrine, think hormone. Our target cell, there are numerous examples of target cells. Our ligand is going to be the hormone, and the hormone must travel through the blood in order to get to its target cell. So because the hormone has to travel through the blood, the target cell is far away from the secretory cell. We start off with the secretory cell that's going to synthesize and secrete the hormone. Once the hormone gets secreted, the hormone's going to travel through the interstitial fluid. Then the hormone is going to travel through the blood. Then the hormone is going to bind to a receptor. Remember, the hormone is the ligand. Once the hormone binds to the receptor, once again, you get your target cell response. Again, you're going to have numerous examples of this when we get into the endocrine system. And then we have the neurohormones. The secretory cell is called a neuron, or you can also call it a neurosecretory cell. Our ligand is the neurohormone. The reason we're calling it a neurohormone is that it's a neuron that makes the hormone, that synthesizes and secretes the hormone. This neurohormone has to travel through the interstitial fluid as well as the blood. And then lastly, we have our target cell. Again, there are numerous examples for a target cell. So we're starting off with our secretory cell, our neurosecretory cell, or neuron. So it has to synthesize and secrete the neurohormone, I'll just abbreviate NH, which has to travel through the interstitial fluid. Then it has to travel through the blood. Then your neurohormone has to bind to the receptor. And lastly, we get a target cell response. So what that's done for us then is it's taken us through how different ligands function. And so based on that function, we classify them as either a paracrine ligand, as a neurotransmitter, as a hormone, or as a neurohormone. hormone. So that concludes part two of the intercellular communication of chemical messengers, and that concludes the functional classification.